brought to you by Penguin.
Please be aware that these essays were originally published between the 1800s and 1900s and contain language, themes, or characterizations which you may find outdated.
Thoughts from the Ice Drinker's Studio by Liang Qichao, read by Daniel York Lowe. Introduction. Liang Qichao became China's preeminent public intellectual shortly after the turn of the 20th century. He invented political journalism, promoted democratic reforms, and introduced Western political theory to Chinese readers. He led China's break from tradition. Forced to flee China for political crimes at the age of 25, he found a welcoming home in Japan, which also provided him with enormous intellectual stimulation. Shortly after Liang's arrival, he began writing a series of short essays that he called Notes on Liberty, often little more than reading notes and quick reflections, as Liang himself described them. Their topics ranged from self-help, ideals and power, and revolution, to short biographies of various heroes. They were bound together by Liang's belief that hope for the future lay in freedom of thought and disinterested pursuit of the truth. In calling himself the master of the Ice Drinker's Studio, Liang cited a story from the Zhuangzi. Namely, in about 500 BCE, Duke Zigao of Shi had been designated the Chu Kingdom's envoy to the Qi Kingdom, meaning he had to deal with the irascible and stubborn rulers of that land. According to the Zhuangzi, Zigao was normally a man of equable temperament, but now he was consumed by anxiety and told Confucius, "I only got my orders this morning. Already I am drinking ice water this evening, and yet my insides are still on fire." Liang was not only saying that he identified with Zigao's anxiety and terror. In the following passage, which Liang did not quote, Confucius told Zigao to devote himself to his assigned task so wholeheartedly that he would forget his own existence and, not worrying about death, he could then carry out his orders successfully. Liang was perhaps also suggesting that he needed ice to cool down his hot-blooded ardour. The master of the Ice Drinker's Studio thus arrived in Japan, announcing his wholehearted devotion to the renovation of China. Over his lifetime, Liang used many self-epithets. Mourning for the times, a patriot, a youth of youthful China, master of the Studio of Liberty, a new citizen of China. But he always returned to the Ice Drinker's Studio. Over the years, Liang was to change his mind on many issues. It is difficult to say precisely that Liang believed this or believed that without specifying which Liang we are talking about. In his own self-evaluation of 1920, he wrote, "I care not if I criticize myself of yesterday with myself of today," and fittingly enough, then criticized himself for having too few convictions and getting carried away by events. Liang had a burning desire for knowledge, and as he acquired new knowledge and as circumstances changed, he was happy to change his mind. Yet his fundamental intellectual commitments were of a piece, and even when his opinions changed, he continued to smuggle in many of his previous views. If, as Liang said, his conservative instincts and his progressive instincts frequently fought against each other within himself, one can often see the progressive in the conservative and the conservative in the progressive. When Liang Qichao was born in 1873, the Qing dynasty had been sponsoring conservative reform projects for a little over a decade. Chinese people, the Han race, had accepted the legitimacy of the Qing, founded in 1644 by Manchu invaders, for two centuries by this time, although currents of anti-Manchuism were bubbling to the fore. The government was turning to reform as officials sought to import Western technology, especially armaments factories. but political and social elites remained conservative insofar as efforts to learn foreign languages, train modern engineers, and send officials abroad remained deliberately limited. The commitment of elites to Confucian ethics of hierarchy and respect was, if anything, reinforced. But they recognized that some reforms were necessary because the government faced unprecedented threats from abroad and massive rebellions at home. Britain forced the Treaty of Nanjing on China at the end of the Opium War in 1842, which was the first of what became known as the Unequal Treaties, signed in the following years with France, the United States, Germany, Russia, Japan, and other countries. In addition to paying large indemnities, which limited any reform programs that the Qing might have wanted to pursue, the Qing was forced to open Chinese cities to Westerners, who quickly built mini-colonies, concessions. Christian missionaries spread across the land, and the numbers of Western and Japanese diplomats and soldiers grew steadily. Liang was born in a farming village in Guangdong province in southeast China. His father ran a village school and farmed. Growing up, Liang had no contact with Western civilization. But he was not too far from the bustling international port of Guangzhou, Canton, where he moved to study in his teens. Liang was extremely precocious. He had soon mastered the Confucian curriculum of the four books and the five classics, and he passed the first level of the examination system at the age of 11. The examination system was the key social and political institution in China for at least 600 years. To pass its higher levels meant an official career beckoned, offering prestige and riches. At the extraordinarily young age of 16, Liang passed the second level. The chief examiner was so impressed that he gave his younger sister to Liang in marriage. She helped Liang learn the northern dialect necessary for official life. And about this time, Liang met Kang Youwei, who lived from 1858 to 1927. Kang taught that Confucius had been a prophet, a reformer, and an institution builder. In fact, a sage king in his own right, rather than a man who simply transmitted China's ancient cultural traditions. In other words, Kang was justifying his calls for radical change not as anti-Confucian, but as representing the true spirit of Confucianism. Equally stunning, Kang reinterpreted a key classical passage to argue that history proceeded through three ages from the age of chaos, through the age of approaching or lesser peace, and finally to the age of universal peace, or Da Tong, utopia. The Da Tong foresaw a future of absolute equality of class, race, and gender, as people lived in a rich and democratic world without families, classes, or nations. Constitutions, parliaments. This was heady stuff for Liang, barely in his 20s. He began to read translations of Western thought, as well as continuing to study the Confucian classics and Buddhist texts. Along with a great many others, Liang was shocked by China's loss to Japan in a war over which empire would dominate Korea that was fought from late 1894 to early 1895. Qing troops were decisively defeated on land and its navy destroyed at sea. It seemed that three decades of reform in China had failed, while Japanese reforms since the Meiji Restoration of 1868 had succeeded. The treaty terms were harsh. Traveling to Beijing for the highest level exams, as it happened, Liang, along with Kang, led a protest against the treaty, which was ignored by the government, but contributed to their growing roles in China's nascent public sphere. Kang passed his exam. Liang failed his. Over the next 3 years, the two men continued to advocate radical reforms and organized study societies to further promote their ideas. What Liang added to Kang's eccentric Confucianism was a large dose of social Darwinism. Liang learned his social Darwinism from Yan Fu, who lived from 1854 to 1921, the great translator of T.H. Huxley. Darwin's bulldog, who in the following years translated Herbert Spencer, Montesquieu, John Stuart Mill, and other mostly British social thinkers. Like Yen Fu, Liang interpreted the struggle for survival at the level of the nation. And although he saw a role for competition among individuals, it was the grouping necessary for China's survival in a dangerous world that he most valued. At different times, Liang emotionally condemned the brutality of Western imperialism.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.